Hello, and welcome to Yardstick Management's DEI in Action virtual series. My name is Selma Shilbaya, and I'm the Chief Communications Officer at Yardstick Management, where I have the honor to oversee all the internal and external communication strategy alignment, marketing, public relations, branding, and project management solutions for our global clients. I've spent most of my career in journalism and higher education, with 7 years at CNN covering international and domestic breaking news as a producer, assignment editor, writer, and in the recent few years in communication consulting and public relations. Simultaneously, I have taught numerous communication courses at various universities, including Georgia State, Bernal, and Clayton State University. And today, I couldn't have asked to be at a much more suitable space to extend my experience and amplify America's leading Black-owned management consulting firm, Yardstick Management. And I'm delighted to be your MC for today's DEI in Action episode, Soaring to the Top, Raising Women Higher in Leadership. Our founder and managing partner, Abby Parsons, has built a legacy of a management consulting firm, serving and impacting some of the biggest name brands in the world, such as Facebook, Netflix, Amazon, LinkedIn, Prudential, Medtronic, and many more. Yardstick has partnered with over 100 companies, government agencies, and higher education institutions in the US, Europe, Africa, and Asia, and the Middle East. Our work has impacted over 2.6 million people globally and has been recognized nationally for its innovation by Inc. magazine as an honoree of Best in Business just this past year. And this year, Yardstick has launched an innovative initiative with our inaugural Leadership Institute. The Institute was held in historic St. Simon's Island in Georgia this past January. Our theme on leadership and vulnerability captured critical conversations that garnered both attendees and speakers from across industries nationwide, including key decision makers from Netflix, CNN, Riot Games, and many more. If you've missed this, don't worry, there's another opportunity. Our second institute is already back by popular demand, and it's taking place on July 27th through the 29th. Early registration is now open, but seats are limited, so please be sure to register soon by visiting our website. Now, we want to welcome our viewers, including our clients and partners from all across the nation during this celebratory Women's History Month. Thank you for joining us. While we're waiting for everyone to join, we want to invite you to introduce yourself via Zoom chat. First, make sure you change your to be directed to everyone. And please tell us your name and where you're Zooming from and anything else you want to share that's relevant to today's conversation. We also want to encourage you to engage with us on social media throughout the program today via LinkedIn, Twitter, and Facebook. Be sure to tag us on your posts and use hashtag YSM Virtual Series and hashtag DEI in Action. We also want to hear from you. You can use the Q&A section of Zoom to ask questions to our panelists throughout the course of the program. We're also going to be asking you several trivia questions. For your convenience and reference, we're including a link of today's program here in the chat, which you should have also received upon registration. The schedule, topic of discussion, and full speaker bios are included in the program. Now, let's get started. We have prepared a stellar lineup of prominent female changemakers who will provide unique insights into how they've challenged disparity in female leadership representation and soared to the top by accelerating change in the corporate gender landscape. These speakers have walked the talk, embedding DEI in the DNA of every organization they've touched, and we're incredibly excited to have them join us today. But before we invite them to the virtual stage, we want to hear from you with our first trivia question that's going to pop up on your screen right now. The question is, 24% of C-level positions are held by women. What percent is held by women of color? Go ahead and make your selection, and let's see if we get it right. As the questions start rolling in, we will pop up the answer shortly. All right, and the results. All right, it looks like we've got 50% of you saying 7% and the other at 4%. The correct answer is 4%. Thank you for participating. Although women's representation has increased across the pipeline since 2016, women, especially women of color, as you could see, still remain significantly underrepresented in leadership. We're witnessing this right now as the nation watches the Supreme Court candidate Ketanji Brown Jackson struggle through the course of ensuring an equitable space as a qualified candidate. Representation of women of color falls off relative to white employees and men of color at every level of the corporate pipeline, leaving women of color severely underrepresented at the top. This is according to a recent McKinsey & Company report. At Yardstick Management, we're proud to say that we practice what we preach, and this is far from our reality within our company. We are intentional about leveling the playing field for marginalized people, including women within our own organization. Women here make more than 67% of our company, with 75% women in the executive leadership team. That means that Eddie is the sole male, in case you all were just wondering. As a matter of fact, our very own president and chief operating officer is a woman of color, and she's here today to kick us off and share more about her experience soaring to the top 4% in this space and leading a fast growth organization. Naima Greenwood serves as president and chief operating officer at Yardstick Management, responsible for growing the Yardstick Management portfolio and managing ongoing projects. Before joining Yardstick, she served as a senior manager on a government contract with the Office of Foreign Labor Certification. Naima has a diverse background in sales, marketing, operations, and retail. She's an advisory board member of the College of Business and Information Science at Tuskegee University. Naima started her career at Target Corporations as a business analyst in the entertainment division. There, she collaborated with major movie studios and record labels in managing their releases. She later relocated to Atlanta, where she resides now, and she managed a $1 billion domestic landscape business for over 2,200 retail stores at the Home Depot. After completing her executive MBA, Naima was recruited by Bank of America, where she served as assistant vice president and oversaw efforts to convert California accounts to a single platform for improved efficiency, reliability, and managed a multi-million dollar project to develop global consumer risk assessment plans for call centers. Please help me welcome to our stage my esteemed colleague and Yardstick Management's Madam President, Naima Greenwood. Naima.
Hello, everyone. Hello, Selma. Welcome.
Welcome to you. It's so nice to have this conversation with you and to share it with everybody, all of our audience. I feel like we talk a lot behind closed doors, but now we get a chance to share out. So as we kick off, Naima, tell us about your journey at Yardstick. How did you go from employee number three to now president and chief operating officer, leading America's Black-owned management consulting firm and its fast growth progress?
Absolutely. Well, it's quite a story. I was home for a while. I had just had a child, a 10-month-old, and I was home taking care of her and getting ready to get back out there and into the workforce. And I got the call from Ebby, right? Ebby and I had been friends for quite some time, and we attended Florida A&M University together. And he simply asked me he was needing help at Yardstick. Didn't know what he wanted me to do yet, but just wanted me to join and help out. So absolutely, when I get a call from Ebby, certainly happy to assist. So I came on as employee number three and really did everything that was asked of me, going above and beyond and really being there to have Ebby's back and support him, right, on this mission. I've been following Yardstick, this is our 10th year. I've been following them since inception and couldn't be more thrilled to be a part of what Ebby was creating here and manifesting. And I'll say from going to employee number three, we have now about 25, 26 employees in 2 years. So as you say, rapid growth. And truly for me, just being scrappy, I've done everything from coaching CEOs on how to respond to their organizations, following the murder of George Floyd to placing Uber Eats orders for our virtual dinners, right? So, and I, you know, can't stress enough, as being a leader, like, you really cannot be beneath doing anything, right? Especially for us, a small organization in growth mode, which is what we are here at Yardstick. I have served in every role here at Yardstick. So as you know, we have an executive search line of business. We have our management consulting pillar, as well as supporting organizations on DEI. And most recently, we launched our inaugural institute. So just being able to be flexible and supporting the team in every facet of our business. And honestly, anything that we've learned during these past 2 years navigating the pandemic is just mastering the pivot, right? Post George Floyd, a lot of organizations realized that maybe they weren't as inclusive or as diverse as they thought that they were, right? So there's this heightened awareness around DEI, and we really leaned in to maximize in that space and coaching leaders, assessing organizations, making sure that they are embedding DEI in everything that they do. And now I'm fortunate to be able to develop my team, support my team on our engagements, and making sure that we are continually making impact.
It's amazing. It's really quite an honor and so impressive to have watched also that progress, and to watch you go through it too as well, Naaman. As you're talking about developing the team, which you do a stellar job in that space, you've also, as you know, most of our team are women, you know, and you've always advocated not only just for women of color, but all minorities and underrepresented disadvantaged groups for some time now, and including in our space. Tell us what you're doing in the current role as president and chief operating officer to empower women of color in leadership.
Well, as you know, Selma, we exist, right, to level the playing field for marginalized communities, people that look like me and you. And I think as moms, we, and women and mothers, we play a different role, right? We are servant leaders, right? We are constantly leading in our households, leading in the C-suite, leading and serving as an example for women to come. You know, I would say probably the biggest thing that I do as a leader is making sure that we are placing women in the C-suite, placing women on corporate boards, women in leadership roles. You know, women don't have to start at entry-level positions, right? We need to have representation at every rung of the organization, from, you know, the internship level all the way up into the C-suite. And honestly, I provide a seat at the table, right, for women, and especially women of color. When I start engaging with a client, the first thing I do is look at their leadership, right? And I ask, where are your women? Where's your representation? Where are your people of color? And they like to tell us, well, we're so diverse, but I don't see that after a manager level, right? So the first thing we need to consider is, how do we, you know, diversify this leadership role? How do your open roles, are you considering, are you bringing diverse slates of candidates? So we really check them, and I'm fortunate to be in the position where I can advise them and they're listening, right? And they're doing the work. And honestly, the best client are the ones who realize that, you know what, you're right. We didn't look around, and we didn't see what we look like from the outside, right? And I always stress that, you know, your organization should reflect the customers that you serve. So we are really walking the walk. I mean, here at Yardstick, as you stated earlier, we're 75% women. And I tell my clients too, look at Yardstick as an example. We're intentional about making sure that we create a space for women, that we elevate them. I'm fortunate to have a leader in Ebby who is constantly elevating women in this space and mentoring them and mentoring myself and helping me develop to be the leader that I am today. Also, I don't want to forget too, with that, equitable pay for women, right? That is the biggest key. So women are consistently making 83 cents on the dollar. We are not one for one with men. And so we do equity analyses. One of the first things I like to do is understand how you are paying and compensating your women, and hoping that I can influence them to right size that and make that right.
I'm so glad that you brought that up, because it's not enough to just have that seat at the table. Is it the same seat as my fellow, you know, male, as my fellow white male or white female, et cetera. So I love that. I'm glad that you brought this up. And part of all of this in advocating for others that we work with and also supporting our clients to do the work is in relationships. Can you tell us more about the power of relationships and the role that it's played in your own career development as well as the work that you do?
I'll tell you, Selma, you know, in the work that we do and just what we see historically, most jobs are filled in your network, right? Before they hit those job postings and those job boards, they are going throughout their network to find out who they know so that they can bring them in, bringing in their friends. We do it too. We all do, right? So there is power there. So I can't stress enough how important it is to develop relationships, strategic relationships, to move this work forward. Even engaging with our clients. And when I'm telling and coaching our team and developing them on, you know, being the best consultants they can be, is forge that relationship with your client. Your client, during the time you are engaged, really becomes your friend, right? Because I want to come in and really help you push this forward, like especially the DEI work that we do. It's a lot of times a check the box activity, and we want them to understand that it's not a line item. And once we embark on this, it's you need to continue the work, continue to do the work. It's not going to, once this engagement is over, that it's done. And I've been able to maintain really great relationships with our clients. You know, going forward, they constantly still call for advice, you know, beyond our engagement, because they realize the power in the relationship. Even thinking about, you know, my last few jobs, I didn't interview because of relationships that I've had, and just that person knowing my caliber and trusting in me and putting that trust and trusting me with their organizations and to lead them in the manner that I do.
Yeah, I have to agree with you. And I think we have such an incredible leader too in Evie, because the value he adds and brings to us and even understanding how to navigate relationships has contributed greatly to this space. And I am curious, is there any particular relationships that you could think about and feel comfortable sharing out with us that have helped you in your own career development? Is there any of them that you feel comfortable sharing with us, and why so?
Sure. Recently, I had the honor of joining Andrew Young to celebrate his 90th birthday. And he has been truly phenomenal and a phenomenal mentor to my husband and I. My husband serves on the board of the Andrew and Walter Young YMCA. He is the board chair, and he's been doing so for about 10 plus years now. And the mentorship that he has bestowed upon us and the opportunities that he has granted us, and just, you know, helping us to understand how to also be servant leaders. You know, we do our 9-to-5s, but also giving back to the community, helping other women, uplifting other women. I'm constantly mentoring young women, helping them, you know, at RY, helping them apply for college, having those conversations. In my work on the board of Tuskegee University, I mentor quite a few students there and helping them matriculate into the workforce and preparing them for that, giving them that professional development training. I was fortunate to get that at Florida A&M, but a lot of universities do not provide that professional development. So a lot of times when you're going into the workforce, you're struggling to navigate in this new space with all of these identities, and you're dealing with all the things. So I want to make sure that I'm able to do my part. Someone has helped me get to where I am and has uplifted me and has sponsored me and mentored me. And I want to just be very clear that mentorship is very different from sponsorship, right? So just being able to lift someone's name in the rooms that I'm afforded to be a part of.
Yeah, I couldn't agree with you more. And in this space, as of course you know, and we've shared out your journey and your career and where you've been, but I'm sure along the line of climbing your own share of ladders, the journey hasn't always remained so stable and, you know, consistent and easy. What has it been like? Maybe share out with us what that journey has been like to get where you are today, and perhaps even some advice or wisdom you can give to women of color, but also to the leaders that are in our space right now who are elevating or should be elevating women of color who desire to be where you are.
Absolutely. The journey has not been easy. I've had to face my fair share of racism, sexism, bigotry along the way. But I will say each experience, favorable and unfavorable, have prepared me for the role I hold today. It has certainly given me very thick skin. And there's just not a lot that you can say to offend me. A lot of times, even being in engagements here at Yardstick, we've had clients that I was just not their cup of tea, right? And it was really just their own biases and, you know, maybe unfamiliar and just being uncomfortable with maybe facing a leader who was of color, and they maybe just have not seen that and really uncomfortable with that. But, you know, I liken this to what we're seeing right now unfolding during the confirmation hearings with our soon to be justice. I'm going to put it into existence, that we're often having to just smile and push through, you know, everything that is thrown at you, which we're seeing on full display, right? We are not afforded the opportunity to throw a tantrum and to complain, right? We have to, you know, put our head down and push forward. And, you know, these experiences, I don't regret any of them, because they have helped me and molded me. And I'm able to share those experiences with women who are coming up behind me, coming up the ranks, and, you know, not letting that interfere with their goal, and just keep their eye on the prize. So, and, you know, if I had to give a young woman advice, the main thing I would say is, you know, just work hard, stay humble, not too humble, right? And bet on yourself. You're your biggest cheerleader. I am fortunate to have an amazing support system in my husband, my parents, my family, my children, and I do this for them every day. Every day I serve with the charge that I have two young girls who are looking up to me and looking at me as their role models, and other young women and women of color and other women who are in leadership positions, and I serve as an example for them. And I will, and I'll leave you in part with these words: make complacency your enemy.
Powerful. That is powerful. That's our quote for the day. Naima, thank you. Thank you so much for sharing the insight. Thank you for leading Yardstick and the team. We appreciate you and value, and I'm sure our audience has also enjoyed this conversation.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thank you so much, Selma.
All right. Now, we want to turn it back to you all and hear from you again through our second trivia question before we move to our next speaker. The question is, in 2021, what percentage of venture capital went to female founders? Now, talking about venture capital, as we know, our next speaker is going to delve into the space. Let's see those answers roll in and how we do. All right, we've got less than 1% representing 64% of you, and 2% at 27% of you. The correct answer is actually 2%. Now, less than 1% actually goes to Black women. Female founders secured only 2% of venture capital in the US in 2021, which is the smallest share since 2016. And a sign that efforts to diversify the famously male-dominated industry are struggling. When women teamed up with a male co-founder, on the other hand, they tended to raise more. Female and male founder teams captured 15.6% to total venture cash in 2021, which is the highest amount since 2017. Our next speaker has ventured successfully in the space of venture capital as the co-founder and CEO of the first venture capital fund built by women of color for women of color. Arianne Simone is an entrepreneur, philanthropist, investor, best-selling author, and international speaker. Arianne is the co-founder and CEO of the Fearless Fund, the first venture capital fund built for women of color by women of color, with a focus on investing in pre-seed, seed level, and Series A financing, which includes institutional investors such as JP Morgan Chase, Bank of America, MasterCard, Alibank, and more. Arianne received her MBA from Florida A&M and is a pioneer in her field. Arianne grew a successful public relations and marketing firm with a portfolio of billion-dollar corporate clients such as Sony Pictures, Walt Disney, Universal, and other Hollywood studios. Possessing an innate ability to guide strategic growth and enhance company value, Arian's resilience has led to her appointment to the board of directors for the Steven Madden Company. She has been recognized by Entrepreneur Magazine as one of the 100 women of impact. Please help me welcome to our virtual stage, Arian Simone. Hello, Arian.
Thank you, Samuel, for that beautiful intro. And thank you all for having me. And thank you, Abby Parsons, as your managing partner, for, of course, extending this invitation. I'm a fan of everything he has done since the 90s. So, yes.
Oh. I love the accuracy of the time. Oh, Arian, yes. It's a pleasure.
And I'm honored to be part of the first cohort of your Yardstick Management Institute. So thank you again.
Yes, thank you. And thank you for speaking there as well. We so appreciate the conversations with you, as you know, Arian. And Fearless Fund, I want you to start us off and tell the audience how it all started and explain what venture capital actually is all about, how it works, and maybe even share out eventually some of those prominent projects you're working on.
Okay, excellent. How this all started. This actually started with the dream and a promise I made to myself as a student at Florida A&M University. I was raising capital for a retail business, mall based, about 2,500 square feet, taking over Walden Books, and needed a couple hundred thousand to get it started. Raise the capital, but what I noticed in that process that very few people who cut checks look like me. So I'm sitting on the floor in the midst of, you know, the hangers and the clothes and everything, getting everything ready for the grand opening. And I made a promise to myself. I said, Arian, don't you worry about this investor landscape, because one day you will be the business investor you were looking for. So I did not know that it would manifest and look to be what it is today. But I knew in my heart that I wanted to be a business investor. After that, closed the store, moved to Los Angeles, built the PR and marketing company, as you mentioned earlier, from the ground up, bootstrapped it. And about 2016, I started being in a lot of meetings with venture capitalists. And I said, you know what? This is how I can make good on this promise. Speed up a little further time, reached out to Ayanna Parsons, Evie's wife, and we met in B school. We met at the School of Business and Industry together. Mm-hmm. And I sold the Parsons on the dream. I said, this is what we're building, this is what we're doing, and this is who we're going to impact. And they were so gamed about it. They were like, yes, let's make history. Now, we didn't know we were going to be making history as the first venture capital fund that's built by a woman of color for a woman of color. And in the words of our madam vice president, we may be the first, but we don't plan on being the last. But yes, we set out to do what some people would have called the impossible, and we are here. And you wanted me to talk about some prominent projects.
Some projects, or actually, you know what, before you even do that, tell us about venture capital. I mean, some people don't really know much of that space. What does that mean? And what does that mean for women of color in particular?
On a very high level, just to keep it as basic and simple to anybody who may be watching who doesn't know, you're exchanging cash for ownership of a business. That is as simple as it gets. Shark Tank is probably the best visual example that you guys have seen of what venture capital looks like.
I would agree. Now tell us about some of those prominent projects that you've been working on, what those looks like, if you could share a few.
Now, I will tell you this. We get asked that question all the time, and it's so difficult because it's just like you're asking me to pick out my favorite kids. So that's what yes. It's kind of tricky. I will give you a few, but I want you to know that all of these women that we have invested in are rock stars. They are on the cover of Essence magazine. They are all throughout the Inc. magazine, where Yardstick Management received an award. If you turn the pages, you will see our portfolio companies in there. They are on everybody's Forbes list. They are changing the game. Just to give a few of the game changers that we have invested in. We invested in Slutty Vegan, which is based in Atlanta, Georgia. They are operating and bringing food and quick serve food to food deserts. Pinky Cole is the founder. They have done an amazing job with just revolutionizing what veganism looks like. They have done 50 city tours. They have hundreds of thousands of social media followers. It is a whole movement. I will move on next to Hairbrella, which is the Rain Hat Reinvented, and their frequently seen on Good Morning America, The View. Beyonce's posted them even up on her website, which is The Rain Hat Reinvented. And the founder is Tracy Pickett of Atlanta, Georgia, Spelman alum, attorney, and inventor. This is not your grandmother's rain hat. This is not the plastic with the plastic tie. This is where fashion meets function. And she showed an amazing job of pivoting during COVID when she took her visor off and added a face shield. And now the medical industry and the hospitality industry is just all over her company. I'll give another one. Since I said a Shark Tank example is basically what we do, Range Beauty. They just won on Shark Tank. They are reinventing how we receive makeup. It is for the forgotten shades for eczema prone and acne skin. And she did. She just landed two sharks on Shark Tank. And the founder is Alicia Scott.
Amazing. Amazing. Congratulations. I could speak to all of these attest and say, especially Saletti Vegan, because of course I like their food, but amazing. Amazing. Thank you for sharing that. And of course, I appreciate the disclaimer. You all could check them out on Fearless Fund also and learn more about the other projects that exist. I want to move us into the direction, because you know, as this goes really, really fast, into the direction of your book, The Fearless Money Mindset, Broke Doesn't Scare Me. What's the story behind that? How did you come to put pen to paper and the motivation in writing that book?
The motivation and pen to paper came from one quote, which is the subtitle, "People have more fear in being broke than they do faith in having abundance." And once you are able to experience the shift from faith to fear as it pertains to money, you will see the results manifest in your life. And that's why I wrote the book.
I love it. I love it. One of my favorite quotes is, "Let your faith be bigger than your fear." I love it. I love it. So you all are encouraged to read it. And to close us out, Arian, you know, what are some words of advice and encouragement that you would share with female entrepreneurs of color and startups, but also those who are the decision makers in the room today right now to help elevate them and get them to be in these like leadership roles, running businesses or making decisions for corporate organizations?
It's very basic. You have to seize the moment and you have to seize opportunities. We don't get to dictate when we receive our blessings. We only get to dictate if we're going to show up for them. So as things start to happen in your life, you have to be willing to show up for the occasion. And I would also like to say that procrastination is just an arrogant way of thinking you're in control of time. So when your blessings start coming to you, you need to show up and show up big every single time.
I love it. Oh, I love it. Lots of gems dropping this morning. Thank you, Arian. Thank you so much for joining us. We wish you and Fearless Fund and everybody involved in the organization lots of future success, and we'll continue watching you and rooting for you. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, we're moving on with another trivia question, our third trivia question that's going to pop up on the screen, and we want to hear from you of emerging C-level positions. Chief Sustainability Officer is surfacing as the third most common position for women entering C-level leadership. What do you think is the first one? Go ahead and make your selection, and let's see how many of us get it right. All right, those answers are rolling in. We've got 80% of you with diversity, equity, and inclusion, and you bet that is correct. That is the correct answer. That is definitely becoming the first most common position for women entering in the C-level. Now, the disparity of representation of women in leadership is prevalent among most industries, as you all know. However, there are a few roles where women are nearly or already are on par with men, including women serving as chief brand and chief sustainability officers. Women's representation across all categories of emerging leadership grew at an annual rate of 17% over the last decade, with brand, data analytics, digital, D&I, and sustainability leading the growth charge. This could indicate that women are increasingly viewed as critical to driving the future success of the industry. Now, our next speaker is a trailblazer in the space of sustainability and continues to take charge of sustaining social and political change throughout her work. Carrie Dugan is a national political advisor, visionary climate tech executive, and a former government official. During the Obama-Biden administration, Dugan served as White House Deputy Director for Policy in the office of then Vice President Biden and Deputy Director of President Obama's Detroit Task Force. Dugan is a leader in the sustainability movement, having been named the founding director of the University of Michigan's SEAAS Sustainability Clinic in Detroit and holding several public leadership roles, including at the USA Department of Energy. Dugan is the founder and CEO of Sustainability, a woman-owned, woman-service-disabled, veteran-operated, Detroit-based diverse small business working with game changers to equitably solve the climate crisis. Dugan is also a corporate board director and advises numerous climate tech companies and funds. Please help me welcome to the stage, Carrie Dugan. Hello.
Hello, and thank you. It's always impossible to listen to that introduction, but thank you.
It's well deserved. We had to cut some of it out too. It's always hard to cut things out, to be honest, because they're all worth mentioning. Carrie, thank you for joining us. Such a pleasure to have you here in the room.
Are you kidding? I just want to sit and listen. I've loved just listening and learning and writing down and underlying what everyone else is saying. So thank you for having me. Thank you, Yardstick. You guys are so much fun. I have to say, Ebby, thanks for inviting me today. Ebby and I go back so many years. So it's an honor to be able to come full circle and partner on something like this.
Fantastic. Carrie, you know, you bring in so much knowledge and information into a space that a lot of us have a lot to learn about, really. So tell us from the standpoint of sustainability, right? The group and its mission. What drew you to that work? And tell us more about what you really do, kind of in lamest terms for us.
Well, picking up from Ariane's comment about, you know, sit up straight when your blessings show up. Sort of an inverse thing happened about 5 years ago. I was working at the White House for the then Vice President, now President, and for President Obama in Detroit, as you said. And we were, I'll just say, politely invited to leave. so I worked, you know, till January 19th. And then I was kind of like, huh, what am I supposed to do next? And of course, I was being recruited for different jobs and contemplating, you know, what the future would look like after basically 7 years of public service. And I had lunch with a prominent recruiter who was in fact recruiting me. Halfway through the lunch, he said, and this is a Black man of prominence, and he said, it wasn't Ebby, you need to hang your own shingle. Your work will come to you. I think we heard that at the top of the call today. And I thought, wow, that seems pretty high risk after 7 years of public service. But I did it. I took the leap of faith, like Naima said, on myself, hung my own shingle. And in 5 years in business, I may have spent $300 on marketing. So,
wow.
Yeah. So I feel very, wow. That's how it happened. And then to answer your actual question of what we do in my shop, as you said, I'm very proud of my diverse team. We only have one male, happens to be my husband, that does some work with us. We work in two areas. One is we work with large institutions and companies that are ripe for that disruption that's happening in the world around the ESG DEI topics. So I get in there with them and I do high level executive work to try and figure out what their play is. And I'm particularly interested in place-based work. So I'm very much grounded in place. I am in Detroit. This is not a fake background. This is where I live and I'm loud and proud about it. The other half of our work is really working with these climate tech solution companies. So the folks who are in fact going to be part of your everyday life in the years ahead, I'm looking for those major disruptors and trying to grow them and scale them nationally and globally at speed. So that, I mean, that really is the growth area of our company. And so it's a lot of fun. And what it means is that I end up partnering with all sorts of people to remove roadblocks for these companies to thrive in municipalities and government and different opportunities. So having a blast, growing a great team, and love partnering with Yardstick.
I love it. I love the journey, Carrie. And man, I'm so interested in how you've managed to only spend $300 on marketing. So we'll have to connect afterwards in that space. But really incredibly fascinating background. I mean, you've worked in the White House, you've worked in also higher education, you've worked across grassroots movements. Your body of work is quite vast and diverse, and you probably have a lot of really awesome stories and not so awesome stories too. How are you able to implement climate change projects in your time in the White House in particular, and as a political advisor? That's very interesting, I think, for all of our audience. Would love to hear from you.
Yeah, well, I had a great benefit of sort of growing my political chops and learning, truly being taught politics. So, you know, we all go to school and get a degree in something or other. We also learn a lot on the margins of our day job and our education. And I think a lot about this. Like Erin, I'm working on a book right now that's going to tell the real stuff. You know, like, where did I really learn how to talk to people? Well, it's being Irish and working in an Irish pub. And that has served me really well later in my career. So those are a lot of like foreshadowing. But when I worked at the White House, I'd come directly from the Department of Energy. And so another sort of what I would call free grad degree, I got to learn about the state of technology, what the cutting edge was on top of my policy experience. So I took all that with me into the White House. I also took 6.5 years of doing ground game work in Detroit into the White House. In fact, that's how I got picked. And I'll talk about that in my book. And Abby, you'll love this. My interview with then Vice President Joe Biden I was introduced, sir, this is in the West Wing office. This is Carrie Dugan. She's from the Department of Energy. She's from Detroit and she played basketball. Guess when he looked up from his desk? Detroit and basketball.
Ah!
And the big interview question was, so what position did you play? And I said, well, sharpshooter, sir. And that was accurate. And I know Ebby's laughing because he knows it's true. And I think I got that job in many ways because I didn't go to Harvard. I went to, you know, a school where there was grit and I worked for everything and I had my head down and I was not a peacock. So that's, I think about, you know, yes, I do high level policy stuff, but it's the being a real human and leading with humanity and probably a smidge of gumption that helped me have success. And then, you know, fast forward many years, as Arian said, I ended up being asked by now President Biden to be on his unity task force to reconcile some policy differences at an extremely high level. This is with Secretary Kerry and Gina McCarthy and Catherine Flowers, who was then from the, you know, the Bernie Sanders campaign. And that's some of the work I'm so proud of because my focus is really environmental justice. That's what I went to graduate school for. And I get to work with some of the brightest minds in the world to figure out how do we actually do that at this moment when DEI is front and center. My piece of that is really addressing the environmental injustices that communities of color and low income have faced. And now we have a president that really cares and an alignment there. So I've got this through line from very early in my career to today where I get to work at that intersection. And that it just brings me joy. It's not work because yes, it's hard and working on climate is daunting, but the people I work with, the network, the passion, the love, it's all there. Mm-hmm. So I feel very, very blessed.
And the impact, the incredible impact. Carrie, when is your book coming out? You need to make sure you let us know so that we can also promote it. Okay, we look forward to that. That's gonna be phenomenal, like insights. So as we're learning, you know, about what you've done and in the space, you know, what can be done to make the climate crisis from your perspective, your expertise perspective, to make the climate crisis a topic that many more of us know about and care about? I mean, you're constantly working to impact. What do you think is almost like the responsibility of those who should kind of learn about it on their own and seek it?
Yeah, well, sadly, because of the way climate is playing out, there's nobody that's safe from a climate impact. You know, wherever you live in the country, in the world, you're being impacted. So I think part of it is truly just recognizing what your impacts are because, you know, from a scientific perspective, there's three options. You can mitigate, adapt, or suffer, or some combination of the three. So I will tell you, I chose to live in Michigan and move back to Detroit after my time in the administration because I'd lived through Hurricane Sandy and experienced the roof blowing off the elevator shaft in our building. And I have two kids. Mm. And so for me, I know that I have a very fancy resume, but I'm a human being and I'm a mom. Like Naima says, like that, I'm centered in that and I'm trying to protect my kids and the planet they're growing up on. So I recognize where the impacts are and then I turn that into action. So you mentioned the Sea Sustainability Clinic here in Detroit, which I'm the founding director of. That's a direct response to our climate impact in Detroit, which is flooding in people's basements. And these, you know, many folks here in Detroit can't afford to do the modifications to their home. So I am diving in, digging in deep where I live in place. And that's what I would say to everybody, no matter where you live, there's something you can find to do in your community. And there are resources now, particularly with the legislation, the federal side that are gonna trickle into your states and you're gonna be able to figure out how to access resources. But if I leave you with anything, it's like, put on your creative thinking hat, because that's what it's really going to take. And that goes all the way up to the federal level in my current role on the Secretary of Energy's Advisory Board. I'm trying to, as quickly as I can, by slowing down and meditating, how can we find creative solutions to these problems? And I practice that in my work. I practice that in partnership, because this is not going to solve itself. The technologies I mentioned, these climate tech solution companies, they can't grow legs and walk in and deploy themselves. It takes relationships, diplomacy, and patience. But everybody can do something where they live. And I do encourage you, if you haven't done some tour of duty in public service, like that's my main thing I wanna see young people get involved in, like encourage them to do that, because it's so rewarding. I have zero regrets about my 7 years in service, but there's ways to do it in your hometown on an advisory board. I know a lot of the folks on the phone are corporate, but you can squeeze out another 5 hours a month to do something in your community.
Thank you for that. And thank you for serving all of us in this space, this very critical space, and sharing information and knowledge for us to carry us through and hopefully go out there encouraging everybody to do their part and be responsible in this space. Thank you, Carrie, so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me, an honor.
All right. So before we wrap up with our next speaker, we want to hear back from you with our fourth trivia question. It's going to pop up on the screen. Here we go. Because of the underrepresentation of women in leadership, many women are told to act more like male peers to progress in the workplace. In reality, the traits expected in leaders are often associated with women. What's the most common of them? Go ahead and make your selection here. Let's see what we get from folks as a response. This has become quite a critical conversation about traits of leadership. All right. And it looks like 50% of our audience have stated that it's all of the above, which is accurate: humility, self-awareness, and empathy. Gender differences in leadership effectiveness, which means what it takes to perform well, are out of sync of gender differences in leadership emergence, which is what it takes to make it to the top. Indeed, research shows that the prevalence of male senior leaders is not a product of superior leadership talent in men. Rather, large quantitative studies, including meta-analysis, indicate that gender differences in leadership talent are either non-existent or they actually favor women. Research shows that women carry top traits of leadership, such as the ones we mentioned, empathy, humility, and self-awareness, far more than men, and therefore are more adept to competent leadership as they're able to relate and connect with those around them. Our next speaker has managed to connect with major recognizable name figures around the world with her ability to tune into her strategic storytelling skills and relatability. She has excelled in the space role modeling strength by soaring in both sports and media. 1988 U.S. Olympian and media professional Leslie Maxey is a born entrepreneur and no stranger to achievement or pushing herself to optimal performance. Leslie began her media career as a reporter. Over the years, she has interviewed some of the biggest names in entertainment and sports, including Jesse Owens, Brad Pitt, Denzel Washington, Angelina Jolie, Serena Williams, Barry Bonds, and Mike Tyson. She did this while being the first professional athlete to cover the world's premier entertainment and sports events outside of her primary sport. Over the last decade, Maxi has executed a strategic move from broadcaster to media maven as principal founder of Maxi Media Group. MMG has quietly lent its expertise to shape the narrative of and provide media training and crisis communication to several influential clients and corporations, including Viacom Networks, 2014 Super Bowl Planning Committee representing the NFL's Commissioner's Office, Toyota Motor Corp, Red Bull Racing Formula One, NASCAR, and New York Jets, Major League Baseball executives, Miss New Jersey pageant, and several Fortune 100 executives. Please help me welcome to the stage, Leslie Maxi. Hello, Leslie.
Hello, Selma. How are you?
I am great. It's so good to have you. Thank you for joining us.
Wonderful to be here. Thank you.
Now we're going to dig right in. I mean, we've got a lot to talk about and time is limited. So as a former women's track fan that you are, you know quite a bit about the gender gaps for women in sports. Tell us what hurdles you had to overcome in order to win in this race called life.
Well, again, thank you for having me. Hi, Ebby. We haven't met yet, but I am looking forward to it. When I think about the things that I've had to overcome to really win in the life that I've looked to create, one of the things that stands out for me was my desire to create content. And Carrie talked about, somebody said, hey, put your shingle out and people will come. And that ended up being my experience as well. When I came to New York, I'm from California, with ESPN, the show that I was on was only here for 3 years. And then they moved up to Bristol. I didn't think I would ever work for ESPN because I didn't want to raise my family in Bristol, but I couldn't in good conscience take my family back to California at that time because New Jersey has such good schools. So I stayed and had to figure it out. And like I said, wanting to create content, you know, being a woman and being a Black woman and having been talent, whenever I said it in a meeting, people looked at me like I was crazy. But there was a moment when I found myself on a private plane with the owner of Red Bull, just he and I. And he wanted me to do PR work for his company. And I had to explain that, you know, I did, even though I had a background in PR, I was not working in it at the time. And PR is something that you really need to keep your contacts up for. And so we're in that plane and the conversation is dying. And I said, you know, excuse me, so I'm going to go to the powder room. And I'm in there, I'm like, figure it out, Leslie. You're on a private plane. These are gold features. Figure it out. And so I came back out and I said, you know, well, what are you doing in the space of television? So he said, well, you know, we have this production company and, you know, they're doing this and that, but it's not really my vision. And I said, well, if I were you, this is what I would do. And I just ran down what I thought Red Bull could be from a television perspective. And he said, you know, it's like you're walking through my mind. He said, okay, so let's do this. He said, I still want you to take the PR assignment for me. He said, but I'll also give you a pilot for Red Bull. And if you can do both of those things, amazing. I'll provide you with what you need to be successful. If you can do both of those things, we can have this work. And so, you know, he provided me everything that we needed from staff to cameramen to producers to do the first pilot. And I also did the work on PR for him with a staff to support me. But I say that to say this, you know, it's not always going to look the way you think it's going to look, but be committed to the outcome and be willing to shift and pivot.
Oh, I love that story. I love it. You were just so flexible. And in the moment, you had an opportunity, you grabbed it. It kind of reminds me of what Arian was saying earlier. I absolutely love that story. Now, not only have you just like navigated that space of being an incredible storyteller throughout, but you've also integrated both the sports and media through the work. Talk to us about the power of embracing both, as well as the work-life integration of that and successfully assessing what's next.
Okay. Well, you know,
and you're a mom,
and my mom. Like... Yes. As a female professional athlete, you know, my parents told me really early that you are not going to be able to make your living doing this, darling. Get your education, network, when I went to the Olympics, it was purely bonus, but it wasn't part of their plan. It was part of my plan, but it wasn't part of their plan. But they were absolutely right, you know, to be able to use those things and use track and field as a stepping stone. What I say about the Olympics is that it is the gift that keeps on giving. It has never let me down. And not just the title, but being able to take the process and apply it to other areas of my life. And so, you know, the integration of media and track for me was something that started really, really young. You know, that interview that you talk about with Jesse Owens, I did that when I was 13 or 14 years old. And I knew I was going to win this championship. I had lost the year before. So I said, okay, I'm not going to run the 100. I'm not a sprinter, but I can high jump. And so I made a shift because I wanted to have access to him. Every kid that won at the ARCO Jesse Owens game had an opportunity to meet him themselves. And so, you know, being able to make that shift, being committed to the outcome of winning the championship and meeting him, but I was able to talk the producer. I was on a show from about 9 years old on, and I was able to talk that producer into giving me a crew to come out on the off chance that I won, and I did. And so, you know, saying to him as he put the gold medal around my neck, and I said, you know, Mr. Owens, would you do an interview with me for a television show that I'm on? And he said, what, you got a camera crew here? I said, as a matter of fact, I do. And brought the crew out. We were on the high jump pits. We had the conversation there. But the takeaway, I think, from that is again, being committed to the outcome. Don't be so wrapped up in how it's going to happen. Just know that if you do the things, if you work the process, if you work in excellence, because excellence is not an accident. It's not going to fall out of the sky and hit you in the head, that you will get the outcome. That's beautiful. And excellence is different than perfection. I truly believe.
Oh, that's beautiful. That is, and that's so important to hear as a woman in particular, because the pressures are high, especially where when you're given an opportunity to lead and be in that space of decision making, right? It's quite extensive. So it's such great advice. You know, we're also constantly expected to be nimble and responsive as women, right? That's the common understanding. What would you say your work has taught you about that?
Wow. You know, when I think about being nimble, I look at in 1984, I missed making the Olympic team by 2/100ths of a second. I can't even clap that fast. And when you miss an Olympic team, you want to go for it again, you've got 4 years. And so it's about the time when people aren't looking. You know, you have to be really clear about the why, really clear about your place and source of intention, because there are times when it is not fun. It does not look glamorous. And if you're really, really clear about why you're doing it and what your intention is, and you're staying in that intention level in a way that will serve the outcome that you're looking to create, you can always get there. But it starts inside. It starts inside.
That is so beautiful. I love also that you talked about behind the scenes when nothing else is happening and your quiet moments, going in and honing in on that. Yeah. Any last kind of parting words of advice specifically to women and those in positions to elevate women in leadership who are joining us today?
Yeah. You know, Selma, I have a saying, and it's actually trademarked. It's, when women rise, we rarely rise alone. So you will invest in women, like what Ariel's doing, investing in women of color, because we don't know how not to work diligently. And there's a difference between working hard and working diligently. We don't know how not to work diligently, how to be special, different, exceptional, because that's how we're compared to everybody else. We have to be up there. And so what I believe is, if we are always striving from a place where we're looking for, how can I create opportunity for somebody else? How can I mention somebody's name in a room that will make a difference for them? That is 10 seconds out of my time. But it could make a career shift, a paradigm shift for someone. And so if we're always in that mindset, yes, we're going through the process, we are striving in a way that is excellent, and knowing that it's not an accident, and knowing that we have the ability, the power, and dare I say, the charge to bring others along with us, we can all succeed.
I love it. I love it, and couldn't agree with you more. This is the work that we're all doing, and so awesome to be partnering with you, Leslie, and to have this conversation, and it continues. It's been an honor speaking with you. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
Well, folks, this wraps up this episode of Soaring to the Top from Yardstick Management's DEI in Action series. I want to thank our panelists and thank all of you for joining us today. Please go to yardstickmanagement.com and subscribe for more news and follow us on all of our social media platforms for continuous updates and future events. Let us know what you think by writing us directly. We'd love to hear from you. Until next time, I'm Salma Shalbaya. Stay well and stay in touch. Thank you.